The governor of my state shamefully defied the Supreme Court order to integrate Little Rock Central High School, go out and hire nationalized the National Guard, and use the power of government to guarantee an equal education to kids in that regard. These two fine women would not have a race but for all the money that's being spent against them. And a lot of it comes from these secret super PACs. One of them is run by Karl Rove. You all remember Karl Rove? The real opponent of Kathy Hochul, the real opponent of Louise Slaughter, is Karl Rove. We ought to write his name in instead of the Republicans. Now, you remember what a great economy they gave you, don't you? You got to follow the money here, folks. One of Clinton's rules of politics. When somebody tells you it's not a money problem, they're always talking about somebody else's problem. So, Kathy says, all I want to do is what works. Her opponent says he will vote with the Democrats exactly 0% of the time. So, if you want another Tea Party extremist in the House, you should vote for him. If you want somebody who will get something done, whether you're a Democrat, an Independent, or a Republican, you got to elect Kathy Hochul to Congress. Let's talk about some of the practical consequences of these races. In one of his rare moments of candor, Governor Romney actually said he would repeal the health care law. How terrible it was. And so will their opponents. And he's bashing, Kathy's opponent is bashing her. How can you Republicans and independents possibly vote for anybody that votes for that terrible thing? The worst thing in the world is the status quo. And now, this is not just a healthcare issue, it's an economic issue. Let me just tell you something. All these people that want to repeal this law, I want to tell you, people say I give people too many facts. Yep, I want you to remember this one thing. In 2009, in the worst year for the economy since the Great Depression, when everybody else was worried about going broke, health insurance profits went up 30%, and 5 million Americans lost their health insurance, and 3.5 million of them had to go on Medicaid, a government program, because their employers could not afford to employ them anymore. That is what they are defending. Don't kid yourself. Now, what has happened since this terrible law was enacted? Well, one of the provisions of the law that they really want to get rid of says that insurance companies have to spend 80 to 85% of their premiums on your health care, not profits or promotion. Oh, they hate that. Well, what's happened? I want you to, this is a New York number. The American people as a whole this year got $1.3 billion in health insurance refunds. New Yorkers, over 1 million of them, got $86 million in refunds on their health insurance premiums. Instead of going up, they went down. What else has happened? For the first time in 51 years, we have had 2 years in a row where health insurance went up 4% or less. It's been 51 years. What else has happened? Three is off. There has already been a rare moment of bipartisan cooperation, because we Democrats don't think we're right all the time. They have already cleaned up the small business reporting requirements, which were too onerous. It passed with an overwhelming bipartisan agreement. Why? Because we don't think we're right all the time. But that's not enough for them. They want to repeal it. And look what they want to do to Medicare. Oh, they say the Democrats robbed Medicare of $716 million. Gutsy claims since Paul Ryan had exactly the same number in his budget. As I said at the Democratic Convention, it takes some real brass to attack somebody for doing what you did. In Ryan, of course, has had to change that cause. Governor Romney wants to take the $16 billion and put it back in and give it to the insurance companies. So, listen to what happened. Did the Democrats and the President cut $1,760 million from Medicare? No. Did any beneficiary use anything? No. What happened? A panel of doctors and other people who study this stuff said, you've got too much inflation written in here. We're getting better at delivering health care. We're going to bring the inflation rate down. And you've guaranteed profit margins that are way too high for the Medicare Advantage program. You know, where you pay them a little more and they give you some preventive services as well as regular Medicare. So they took that money and they closed the donut hole, which thousands of New Yorkers fall into. Cost them $600 more a year in drug prices. And they made it affordable for insurance companies to give health insurance to families with pre-existing conditions. And look, this has already been done. So if it was the end of the world, all the stuff that Governor Romney says, well, you'd see it. I mean, people would practically be dropping dead right here at the ground. So what happened to that Medicare Advantage program? We had more insurance companies than ever before wanting to give it. 17% more people enrolled in it. And the cost to the people went down 16%. Barack Obama and the Democrats and Republicans have strengthened health care, they have strengthened Medicare, they have not weakened it. So one of the things that is at stake in this election is whether you want to give the $716 billion back to the insurers, open the donut hole and take $600 away from the seniors in the drug program. And guess what else? Instead of the Medicare Trust Fund now lasts till 2024. That gives us a good bit of time to see if we can bring healthcare costs in line with inflation before we have to think about what else to do to preserve Medicare. Under their plan, the Medicare Trust Fund would go broke in 2016, just 4 years from today, which would give them their wish to privatize Medicare and voucherize it. Now, here's what's the matter with that, folks. Practical terms. Let's not talk about government versus private. Practical terms. In the last 40 years, private insurance costs have gone up nearly twice as much as the Medicare program's costs. So why in the wide world would you say, seniors, I'm really going to help you, or near seniors, I'm really going to help you. I'm going to put you in a more expensive program so I can give another tax cut to upper-income Americans. The other thing I want to tell you about is this. Kathy Hochul has proved that she will vote with Republicans to cut spending. Barack Obama has supported a budget that will reduce the debt by $4 trillion over the next decade. It has 2.5 times as much spending cuts as revenue increases. And as people like me, who got most of the income gains for the last decade and most of the tax cuts, to say, hey, you ought to go back and pay what you did when Bill Clinton was president, because after all, you got big income gains and the rest of America didn't, and you got big tax cuts and the rest of America didn't. And everybody else's income is flat. Somebody's got to pay. It needs to be you. It's nothing but fair. We're not punishing success. We're asking us to be one country again. And most importantly, the arithmetic adds up. People ask me all the time, how'd you balance a budget? I said, arithmetic. You know, I'm from Arkansas, I went to public school, I was so dumb, I didn't know that 2 and 2 wasn't 4 in Washington, D.C. Now we're laughing, but look at the Romney budget. He didn't mean to, but Governor Romney finally admitted in the second debate he was going to give me another tax cut. But you had to listen, because he's gone from endorsing the Ryan budget but making it worse by having even bigger tax cuts and even more spending than Ryan did. Now he's got a hide-and-seek budget. Well, what about this detail, Governor, and that detail, and they'll see me about that after the election. I'm a budget guy, I'm a business guy. As the president said in the debate, if I came to you and Bain Capital, I said, I got a new business proposal, we're going to make lots of money. Give me the money. Well, where's your projected expenses and profit statement? I'll tell you in a couple of years. Governor, you're going to run me out of the office. Mitt Romney, the businessman, wouldn't give Mitt Romney's budget any money, and you shouldn't give him your vote because he did that. She voted for real spending cuts. Kathy voted for real spending cuts to bring the debt down. I'm telling you, this budget, and I know a little something about balancing the budget. Here's what you have to do. The balanced budget, or in this case, just to bring the debt down $4 trillion for the next decade, you got to have three things. You got to have spending restraint, adequate revenues, and economic growth. That's why that Census Votes report and everybody else that's looked at it says we ought to start easy and step it up, because you don't want to cut off the economic growth that's just started. And our interest rates are still below inflation. The American government can borrow money cheaper than anybody in the world. Except the Germans and the British, we can all borrow money cheaper. Now, what they want to do is go to austerity now to pay for tax cuts now. Now, Governor Romney said he didn't mean for you to hear this, but I was paying attention. Remember how he said, the wealthiest Americans will not pay a smaller percentage of the taxes than they do now. Do you remember when he said that? Then he said he was going to cut everybody else's taxes, which means he has to cut mine or I'd be paying a bigger percentage. Right? So he did tell us he's going to give another round of tax increases to upper income people. And Congressman Ryan in the vice presidential debate with Joe Biden didn't mean to, but he also told us it's going to blow a big hole in the deficit. Because what he said, and I was listening, was that they had $1 trillion in repeals of various subsidies and breaks for corporations that they could use to offset a lower corporate tax rate. Now, I'm for that, and you should be too, because our corporate tax rate is no longer competitive, and if we made it competitive, we'd get $500 million or more dollars back in America to put Americans back to work. That's a good thing. But the president's for that too, and so are Louise and Kathy. Then he said, and we got another $1 trillion in deductions we can repeal for upper-income people that'll lower the debt. The problem is, they got a $5 trillion tax cut for them. And the last time I checked, 5 minus 2 left 3. And they're going to spend $2 trillion on defense the Pentagon doesn't want, so you're back up to 5. Now, they had that debt clock running at the Republican convention. I saw it. They saw it's the worst problem in the world. If somebody hired you to fill in a hole, would you get in that hole and say, I'll do that, but first of all, I want to dig it just as deep as I can. Just see if I can fill in a deeper hole. Now, they only have 3 options. They either got to repeal your exemptions and raise your taxes. They say they won't do that. They got 2 other options. They can just blow up the debt like they did before I got there and after I left. Or they can literally gut the money we invest in you and your future. Gut preschool education. Gut education. They want to repeal the student loan law, which I believe Louise Slaughter brought to the floor of the House. It's the greatest. Now, Rochester's a great university town. And they will generate a 21st century economy with you if you will work with them. In new technologies, and new jobs, and new training programs. But not if you've got all this money. And they'll have to do it. They'll have to virtually erase the role of the federal government in educating people, training people, and building the research and development we need for a 21st century economy. There is no other place to get the money. That's the arithmetic, and it would be terrible. I don't think there's a member of Congress that's bought more specific job-related projects to our district than Louise Slaughter has. They want to give me another tax cut, and it's wrong. It is wrong. And I'll tell you something else they do. And this really stings me. They want to block grant the Medicaid program, cut it by 25%, and send it to New York and say, hey, baby, it's your problem now. Now, let me tell you. Some of them say, oh, it's just a bunch of poor kids. What do I care? Well, about 39% of it is health care for lower-income kids. But most of those parents work. And they're not all minority voters who normally vote Democrat. A lot of them are African-American and Latino, but most of them are white. 1% of Medicare, Medicaid, you know what it goes to? It goes to thousands of New York seniors on Medicare who have to live in nursing homes and have spent down their private resources, so the nursing home bill is paid for by Medicaid. You really want to pick, you want to be the one who picks the 25% of them that get thrown out of the nursing home? That's what's in the Ryan budget. That's what this presidential campaign's about. That's what their opponents will vote for unless you re-elect them. If you care about that, you got to vote for Kathy Hochul, and you got to vote for Louise Slaughter. The rest of the 61% of Medicaid goes to parents, most of whom are middle-class people, some of whom are upper-middle-class people, whose children have autistic conditions, were born with cerebral palsy, were born with muscular dystrophy, were born with developmental disabilities, and they cost a lot to take care of. So we started as a country, because we believe we're all in this together, a long time ago, we started saying, let's help these people so they don't have to give up their jobs. A lot of these families, even where there's two parents at home, both of them are working, and the kids are expensive. And I know a lot about this, because they tried to do this when I was president. That's one of the reasons they shut the government down, because I vetoed that sucker as quick as it came to me. Look, this is serious. Not all that stuff you hear the commentators talking about, and who did what with their body language and all that. This is people's lives. I did over 300 events for Hillary when she was running for president. She was on the autism caucus. I talked about autism in every one of them. I didn't speak at one, not one, that somebody in that crowd didn't mention to me that somebody in their family was dealing with just that. I was at a back porch rally in Webster, South Dakota, and the first woman I shook hands with was weeping because she had a severely autistic child who had just passed away. Now, I'm telling you folks, those of us who've been raised with nothing but healthy children know it's a blessing. Those of us who've had children who had Down syndrome or other problems, we know they're a blessing too. We know we need help. And I do not want to ratify the decision of people who would give me another tax cut and gut the program to help those good middle class families to be good citizens and raise their children with dignity. And I don't think you do too, no matter what your political affiliation is. And the way, the 10-year state program, I already said, I think the university here can lead you into a new economy. I see it going on everywhere in America. So here's the deal. We still rank first or second in the world in the percentage of our young people going to college. But in the last decade, we fell to 16th in the world in the percentage of our young adults with four-year degrees. That's bad news for us. How come that happened? Because of the cost, right? People were afraid they couldn't borrow any more money. If they did borrow it, they never be able to pay it. The cost of college is going up at twice the rate of inflation. So what happened? The most important but not very well-known reform of the last 4 years was to change the college loan system. So now, the university, let's say here in Rochester, the university will certify the people that are eligible for a federal loan. The government will send them the money and set aside a loan in reserve against default. That's cheaper for the students than just subsidizing the banks, which is the way we used to do it. Guarantee them 90% of the loan and they can charge whatever they want. It's cheaper. More importantly, now, for the first time, every student in America that gets a college loan, starting next year when this is fully implemented, will have the option to pay back that loan as a small, fixed percentage of their income for up to 20 years. Now, what does that mean? Now, what all the young people here listening to me, you know anybody that's under 25 that's debating about who to vote for or whether to vote, you need to tell them this. Because for you, it's the most important reason to re-elect Louise and Kathy. For you, it's the most important reason to re-elect the president. Now listen, what this means is that nobody will ever have to drop out of school again because of the cost. And what it means is, if you get out of college and you want to go to a little town in New York without a lot of tax breaks to teach school, or if you want to go out to a rural clinic or an inner city clinic and be a community nurse, or if you graduate from medical school with a bill of over $200,000, which is the average debt of a medical school, grants uncertain, and the maintenance of tax credits uncertain. Now, if you're for that, by all means, vote for them. If you're not, you need to re-elect Kathy Hochul and Louise Slaughter and give them a chance to keep fighting for them. One other thing that means a lot to me, Louise talks a little about her record and the Violence Against Women's Act, which is an important thing that I pushed. But you need to know that while she was a great grassroots representative, all these years she's taken care of things, and you all clap so you know about all these projects she's brought to Rochester. But she also made it her business to try to stay on the forefront of science and technology and its practical implications for the people of this district, this state, and this nation. And I can give you lots of examples. She finally got a bill passed to prevent genetic discrimination. So we will keep looking into ourselves and find out if young women have a predisposition to breast cancer. They can start getting annual mammograms earlier. We can eliminate deaths from breast cancer because of that. And yet, for more investments in science and technology because she knows that they will create more jobs, more new businesses, more new opportunities. And because of the internet, those places that create those jobs can be in Rochester just as well as they can be in Boston or New York City or Silicon Valley or any place else. She did that. And I've seen so many snide references. Louise breaking her leg, let me tell you something. When you reach a certain age, I know this, I hate it. Not too hard to break your leg, but you love it with your brain. And there will be every day when there's anything wrong with her brain or her heart. So I just tell you folks, what works is cooperation, not conflict. What works is having a good economy and a good government. Are we where we want to be? No. We had to stop this country from going into a depression. I have said this till I'm blue in the face, and I'm going to say it again. Nobody who ever served as president, no one who ever could have served as president, could have brought this economy all the way back in 4 years. The leading expert on this subject is a Nobel Prize winning economist named Kenneth Rogoff, who teaches at Harvard and is, I believe, a modern Republican. And I actually read his book, read the section on America twice, called him and I said, just tell me the truth. How fast can we return to full employment? He said, first we have to recognize we're not returning anywhere, we're creating a new economy. You can't give them back. If you were president, you couldn't give them back the 1990s economy, you got to give them a new economy. And he said, I would say normally 8 years from the bottom, that is 8 years after July of 2009, but he said, maybe we can do it faster because we've got all this new energy. We're first or second in the world in the capacity to generate electricity from the sun and the wind. We've got this great technological infrastructure. We've got great research and development capacity in our universities. We've got access to venture capital. It's pretty easy to start a small business. So if you have the right policies, you can do it a little quicker than that. So the president and the Democrats, we want to finish cleaning up the housing mess. We want to create an infrastructure bank that would help upstate New York enormously by mixing public and private money in a cooperative venture to put people to work, build the things we all need building. You want rural New York to be able to access the modern economy? We got to deal with the fact that South Korea's computer download speeds are 4 times as fast as ours. And that's a job for public-private cooperation. We got a plan. Or you can choose the other way. Go back to trickle-down economics. Deregulate the financial industry again. They're the banks in the best shape they've been in 20 years. We've got a law that says that when they do these funny little derivatives that cost so much money when the collapse came, now they got to trade them and be open and honest. And if they fail again, there won't be a bailout because there'll be a structured bankruptcy. That's what they want to get rid of. They want to go back to the same system that got us in trouble in the first place. Kathy and Louise will vote to uphold. If somebody's got a good argument about how they can be improved of those laws, they'll do that. You don't want to repeal that vote. You do not want to get rid of it. Remember what your mother told you when you were little. If something sounds too good to be true, it probably is. You got a real budget that will really bring the debt down while investing in our future and creating jobs, and you got this hide-and-seek budget with no money. You got a clear choice here. And you need to talk. The reason I have talked to you like this, instead of giving you some political what to do, is we got 2 weeks left in this election, and there's plenty of people who are not in this beautiful armory today, and you need to make it your business every day to talk to as many of those